Rita if she would say whatever is on her heart tonight, and then we'll just go right to Brother Doug, because this is the time to hear from the two of you.
All right. I just told Doug, I said, I'm not sure how much I've got tonight, so I guess I got something, right?
Right.
I think what I'm hearing the Lord speak is a little bit about courage, and I was reading some things about, you know, how the Lord is always telling us through the scripture. If you look out through the scripture, there's always something of encouragement or taking courage and stuff. And I was just looking over some of the times when, you know, like when Jesus was walking out on the water to the boat, and the disciples were in the boat, the wind was getting tough, and he said, basically, take courage, it's I, you know. and then bid Peter to come to him. And then, you know, in another place where Paul was, you know, he had been, had the salvation experience, and he was brought before, you know, anyway, he was getting ground, you know, basically it says Jesus came and stood beside him.
Amen.
And you know, in a season where I feel like the whole body of Christ is hearing that word of to take courage, take new steps.
Amen.
To walk out your faith. And I think it's interesting that those two scriptures, those two places, was very evident when Jesus says, take courage, he's there. He doesn't give us something without saying, I'm going to be there. When he says, take courage, you can count on his faithfulness to show up. And so when we hear the words, take courage, be of good heart, receive encouragement from the scripture so you can have hope, these kinds of things, it's, you know, he is so able and so faithful to, he just doesn't say take courage and then just, okay, I'll see y'all later. he says, I will come stand beside you and see you through this. And so that's basically, you know, what I'm hearing is for the body of Christ is that it's a season that that he is causing new things to be put in our hearts, old things that we have not fulfilled, that he's saying, now's the time. Whatever it is, the Lord is re-emphasizing things in our heart. And he's saying, I have courage. And he doesn't condemn us. You know, he does not condemn. He said, you know, it's not in him to condemn. He said, it's not from me. And so he may say, you know, you've gone around this mountain and it's time to take courage. And like when Joshua was encouraged, he was encouraged to lead, to inherit the promise. You know, he was commissioned to do so. And as the body of Christ, we are commissioned to do things in the kingdom and to take courage and carry those things out. So, Father, I thank you that for each one, Lord, it'll be different, but we will see you come and stand alongside. And in that boat, when Peter got back into the water, into the boat with them, he says, and they all in the boat worshiped the Lord. And, you know, when we begin to act upon his encouragement and his say-so, and he comes alongside, it's going to produce within his people a heart of worship. And that's why we are set free, just like the children of Israelite. I want to set my children free so they can come and worship. And so let's receive that call, that we be people of worship, and people that can be encouraged and also encourage and come alongside others.
Yeah. Amen.
Amen.
Isn't she awesome, man? She's amazing. Hey, well, it's nice to meet y'all and see all the new faces and some of the old faces that we've known for several years and consider part of our family and appreciate all the prayers and intercession and the love you've shown us over the years. And it's always a joy to be with Fred and Sherry, and I kind of get tickled. You know, Sherry said at the opening that, you know, we've kind of encouraged her along in her faith. You know, but I think there's probably been a little encouragement. She's encouraged us along in our faith too at times. You know, the scripture, the iron sharpens iron, you know, it's, but there was at the beginning of the year, I was just kind of asking the Lord what this year was going to hold. Of course, we're just in such a crazy season this with everything that's going on and you know, just kind of seemed like people's lost hope and just got discouraged and had their dreams and the balloons popped and, you know, everything. And I felt like it was three words the Lord gave me. It was the word, the seed, and the purpose. And I think that's something that we, you know, we need to do some research on. I'd encourage each of y'all to just go back and look at, you know, the word, the seed, and its purpose. When we receive his word, you know, the word plants a seed in us. And as that seed, you know, is planted in us and takes root and dies and brings forth fruit, then it fulfills its purpose. And there's a principle that God's doing, you know, with his word, his seed, and his purpose, and which is good. But I'm not going to talk about that tonight. There were some other things I felt like I really needed to share. But one of the scriptures on the word, seed, and purpose, it was in Ezekiel, Ezekiel 12, verse 28, it sums up what he was saying to Israel. But the last part of it, it says, therefore say to them, thus saith the Lord God, none of my words will be delayed any longer. Whatever word I speak will be performed, declares the Lord. And I felt like this, the Lord gave me that for this year, that, you know, we've all received words and we've all received prophecies and we've all, you know, had dreams and we've all had visions and you know, some of them we've experienced and some of them's already happened and some of them we wished hadn't happened, but they happened and they produced in us, you know, long suffering and patience and endurance and joy and all the stuff it does. But I think, you know, the Lord he's wanting to make himself known on the earth. And it's interesting. I was driving out to the farm the other day and there was a big pile of trees that had been piled up and they was getting ready to burn them from the storms we had here. And so they set them afire and then that coal fell here and we had 11 to 12 inches of snow on top of this big pile of wood that was set on fire. And, you know, so about 10 days, it was just cold and there wasn't anything going on. But we went by there yesterday or the day before where that fire was burning underneath all that snow and under all that moisture. And it actually burnt the snow up and it burnt and the wood was completely burnt to the ground. So the pile of shrubs and tree trunks was, you know, that set fire. The fire accomplished what, you know, what it was there to do, even with all the snow and with all the rain we had, the fire was not put out. And there's a fire that God has birthed within us. You know, and he called us, he chose us, and he pointed us. John 15 says, I've called you, I've chosen you, and I've pointed you to go and do good works. And whatever you need to do those good works, ask me and I will do it. And then some of the scriptures, there's two scriptures basically that I feel like the Lord gave me for this evening to share, or three, I guess. But 1 Peter 2:9, and I'm just stirring up your mind by way of remembrance. You know all these things. But 1 Peter 2:9 in the New American Standard, it says, but you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for God's own possession, so that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who has called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Verse 10, for once you were not a people, but now you are the people of God. You had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. Now, this has given us a definition of who we are. It says, we are now a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for God's own possession. You know, we didn't choose him. He said he chose us. And he chose us not that we would just die and go to heaven and have, you know, eternity in heaven in his presence, but he called us and he chose us for a purpose here on the earth. You know, Ephesians talks about, I've called you, I've predestined you for the works I've called you in Christ. And I want to read 1 Peter 2 in the Passion. Now look what it says in the Passion. It says, but you are God's chosen treasure, priests who are kings, a spiritual nation set apart as God's devoted one. He called you out of darkness to experience his marvelous light, and now he claims you as his very own. He did this so that you would broadcast his glorious wonders throughout the world. Now, that's pretty good, but let's look at what the Message says now in that same scripture. It says, but you are the ones chosen by God, chosen for a high calling of priestly work, chosen to be a holy people, God's instruments to do his work and to speak out for him and to tell others of the night and day difference he made in your life, from nothing to something, from rejected to accepted. And I think this is a season that God is wanting to really release who he is on the earth like we've not seen since the Jesus movement in the 70s. Rita and I was both saved in the 70s and filled with the Holy Spirit. And, you know, we was ex-hippies that got encountered God's love and was transformed by his love and his goodness and called out of the darkness into the light. And we both had a background of sin and people always want us to share our testimony. Well, you know, to me, the testimony of someone that never has sinned, never had, you know, never served the Lord all his life, that's the testimony. I just had no dumb spirit got on me, and God, by his grace and his love, mercy, saved me, you know. So, yeah, my testimony is how stupid I was, you know. To me, the testimony is, well, you know, I never did anything. I just loved the Lord all my life, and I was a virgin when I got married, and I didn't know anything but his love, and I've served him all my life. To me, that's a testimony. But God has chosen us, each of us, and he's called us out of darkness into light to broadcast who he is and to share what he's done in our lives. This last couple of months, I guess, 2 months now, I got an invitation to attend the First Baptist Church men's meeting on Thursday morning at 6:00, and to come and just share and be a part of building a relationship with these 15 Baptist men. And, you know, three of them are they're not deacons. What are they called? They're deacons. They're not elders, but they're scripturally the elders, but Baptists, they're deacons, I guess. And I've really enjoyed just going and just, I had to lay down my preconceived judgments. Well, you know, what they're going to do and what was going to be said. And it's been interesting to see that they've just had a hunger for the things of the Spirit, and, you know, they're tired of hearing, and they're wanting to be a doer now of what they've heard, and they're, God's really opening their hearts and their spirits just to the visitation of this Holy Spirit. You know, they've always talked about the Holy Spirit, but they've never, they've never really encountered the power of the Holy Spirit. And I told one of the guys that's there, I said, y'all are getting ready to get in trouble, because, you know, God's going to take you serious for what you're speaking. And so I'm kind of looking forward to seeing, you know, what God's going to do there. Because, you know, the world is in an uncertain place right now. And the only hope and the only salvation there is in the world right now is in Jesus Christ. You know, it's coming into a relationship of knowing that God's our Father and Jesus is our brother and the Holy Spirit's our friend, and begin to understand our position in Christ, that it's in him we live and we move and we have our being. And I really think that, God is wanting us to begin to come into the mindset that Christ had, which he only did what he saw the Father do, he only spoke what he heard the Father speak. And I sense it's a season that, you know, God is preparing us and has prepared us for such a time as this to be the expression of who he is on the earth. You know, because we are, you know, not by our choosing, but by his choosing, we are now the sons of God. We are the family of God, chosen by him to express himself on the earth. You know, Luke 9, let's look at Luke 9. I'm trying to be Freddie White 9 using this high-tech internet stuff. You know, I usually use my Bible because it doesn't have a mind of its own, but this iPad, it goes places I don't know where I'm going sometimes. But, you know, Luke 9, now this is in the New American Standard. It says, and he called the 12 together, and he gave them power and authority over all the demons and to heal diseases. And he sent them out to proclaim the kingdom of God and to perform healing. You know, this is our commission. And you know, we know this. And like I say, I'm just stirring up our minds by way of remembrance. But, you know, he could say, I've called the Sherry and Fred White Zoom meeting tonight, and I've set you aside, and I've given you power and authority over all the demons to heal the diseases, and I'm sending you out to proclaim the kingdom and perform healing. Well, to me, that's action. You know, he didn't say I'm sending you out to observe the kingdom and to observe the power. He said, I've sent you out to proclaim and to do, to be the kingdom and to proclaim the things the kingdom has. I like what it says in the Passion. It says, Jesus summoned together his 12 apostles and imparted to them authority over every demon and the power to heal every disease. He commissioned them to proclaim the kingdom of God and to heal the sick and to demonstrate that the kingdom of God had arrived. And he sent them out and he gave them instructions. You know, do we really believe this, or is this just good preaching? You know, do we really think that, you know, this is our predestined call? You know, there's no place in scripture that I can see that you know, God just called us to be saved and go to heaven. It seems like he called us for a purpose. He's called us for a reason. He's called us and given us grace, and he's given us the Holy Spirit to empower us to do the things he's predestined for us in Christ. You know, the scripture says that we are seated in heavenly places with Christ Jesus, and that's our position. Yeah, that's great, but our condition is here on the earth, and, you know, we got to take the authority that he's given us from our position and begin to proclaim it in our condition and begin to watch what God wants to do around us. You know, the worst thing that can happen when you pray for somebody is nothing. But what could happen when you pray for them? I mean, the kingdom of God can be established. The power of the Holy Spirit can be released. Demons can be cast out. Blind eyes can be opened. You know, deaf ears can be opened. And, you know, I think that's why we have to realize that, you know, God's really not so much concerned with our intellectual understanding as he's concerned with our faith to believe. And so many times we get an intellectual understanding of something and we think, well, yeah, I've heard that message. I've even taught that message. So I know that message. Well, what are you living in that message? You know, it's one thing to hear a message, you know, that Jesus even told the disciples, says, you know, you search the scriptures, not the disciples, but the Pharisees, says, you search the scriptures because you think in them you find eternal life, but you're unwilling to come to me and to know me. You know, the scriptures are amazing things. And you know, God honors the word, the scripture, you know, Jesus became, the word became flesh. So God's not going to do anything. It's not, you know, confirmed in his scripture, but just sit around and studying the scripture without any action to what the scripture says, you know, we're just, you know, that causes frustration, I think, you know, what Rita was talking about. I mean, you know, when Jesus walked up, he basically rebuked his disciples because he said, you know, where's your faith? What are you doing? I've already spoken to you. I was going to see you on the other side, you know, so we've got to begin to take ownership of the grace that God has given us in Christ Jesus and begin to walk in it. The message in Luke, it says, Jesus now called the 12 and gave them authority and powers with all the demons to cure diseases. He commissioned them to preach the good news of the kingdom and to heal the sick. You know, our commission is, we've got a job description, and you know, everyone, what is it, in 1 Corinthians or 2 Corinthians, where Jesus says, I've given us the ministry of reconciliation, you know, reconciling men under the Father. And you know, evangelism is just, is not telling someone they're going to die and go to hell if they don't know Jesus. Evangelism is introducing the love of the Father and saying, hey, my Father has a plan for you. My brother died for you. And my friend, the Holy Spirit, wants to impart to you the things my Father is predestined for you. You know, are you tired of where you're at? Let me bring you into a new place where God has for you. And the good news of the gospel, not the fear of going to hell. It's the good news of the gospel. It's the mystery of Christ, Christ in you, the hope of glory. And, you know, God wants to show himself off and demonstrate his love to the world. And he's, you know, he's chose us to be that tool to use to demonstrate his love. And that's what's kind of encouraging to me with the Baptists down here. You know, we, the other day they was talking about, well, what are prophets? You know, they're talking about, you know, is prophecy real for today? You know, of course, a lot of that conversation came out of all the, you know, the prophecies about President Trump and all that. And you know, but it still stirred up a conversation, you know, that, that was able to lay some foundation and to say, yeah, there are such things as prophets. And there was one of the Baptist guys down there. He said, well, I think I might be a prophet because God's always showing me stuff and I'm speaking things, you know. And I thought, well, that's pretty cool that, you know, this Baptist thought he was a prophet now. And I, you know, so let him speak, you know. Or, you know, someone said, well, I might be an apostle. What, you know, what are apostles and prophets? They're basically just men and women of God sent out to speak and proclaim God's purpose and establish his kingdom. So in a sense, we all have the, you know, the anointing within us to do apostolic and prophetic things. We might not be Ephesians 4 apostles and prophets, but Jesus in us is the apostle. Jesus in us is the prophet. Jesus in us is the pastor and the teacher and the evangelist. So the Jesus in us can do whatever he wants to do wherever we're at to accomplish what we need. So, you know, don't limit ourselves because we think, well, I'm really going to have that grace. I don't have that anointing. Well, you have Jesus. That's all you need. And if Jesus in you is wanting to speak through you to do the work of God for you, then all you got to do is just open your mouth and be still and watch what he does. You know, I love in Mark 16, let's look at Mark 16. I know I'm going kind of hurly, but Fred said I just got an hour. So we're just, you know, we're covering this deal. If you have questions, ask Fred and Sherry. They can explain everything to you.
You do what the Spirit tells you to do, brother.
But now there, in Mark 16, verse 20, it says, now this is in the message, it says, then the Master Jesus, after briefing them, was taken up to heaven, and he sat down beside God in a place of honor, and then the disciples went everywhere preaching, the Master working right with them, validating the message with irrefutable evidence. Now, that's exciting to me. Here's what Jesus is saying. He said, now I'm sitting down at the right hand of the Father and that God has placed honor, and disciples went everywhere preaching, and the Master, Jesus Christ, working right with them, validating the message with irrefutable evidence. When we hear the word of the Lord, when we see what God is doing and we go out, I mean, the scripture says we are now the household of God. You know, God himself inhabits within us. Christ lives within us. The Holy Spirit lives within us. So when we go out in faith and obedience to what we hear and see the Spirit of the Lord speaking to us, then Jesus says, I'm right there with you, validating that which I've asked you to do. So if you take that concept with the scripture, it's in Christ now, we live and move and have our being. Or the scripture that says it's no longer I, but Christ in me, working through me to accomplish God's purpose for me. How can we fail in what God's called us to do in these days? Because Christ is in us and validating the things we've heard from him, we've seen from him, And he's, you know, the only thing that's limiting him on the earth, as far as in my little sphere, what I do, is me. The devil can't limit what God wants to do. Situations can't limit what God wants to do. I'm the only one that can limit what God wants to do by not believing what he says. Amen? Now let's look over in that same scripture what the Passion says. In what was it, Matthew 16, verse 20. He said, now this is the Passion. It says, and the apostles went out announcing the good news everywhere as the Lord himself consistently worked with them, validating the message they preached with miracles and signs that accomplished them. Now, you know, I can't heal anybody. I can't save anybody. I can't deliver anybody. But the Jesus in me can do all things. And when we take off the limitations and we take off the fear of failure, I mean, that one scripture, you know, it talks about he takes us from rejected to accepted. So when we begin to have the mind of Christ and we begin to realize that it's not what I do, it's what he does in me and through me that's going to change the atmosphere around me. All we are just vessels that he wants to use. So when we just say, yes, Lord, and we go to the place, then the promise of Isaiah, where it says the word of the Lord will not return until accomplish what he sent it there to do. You know, it says as rain falls from heaven, you know, it waters the soil. When we go out as the expression of who he is, as the word, as the seed, as the in the purpose of what he's called us to do, that God says we will not return until we accomplish what he sent us there to do.
Amen. Amen.
Now that's a promise of the Lord. That's the kingdom principle, that the seed will produce what the seed has been called to do. And because the seed has a purpose, you know, the word has a purpose. You know, faith comes by hearing, hearing by the word. So when we take ownership of the word that we hear and let it become a seed within us to begin to take root within us, then the purpose of that seed is going to begin to sprout out of us. And we're going to begin to not only see and taste, but we're going to experience the fullness of what God has called us to.
You know, amen.
Therefore, what can hinder you? What can separate you from the will of God? What weapon formed against you can prosper? What plan of the enemy can succeed? Because it's the word in you going through you to accomplish God's purpose for you. Now, yeah, there's going to be some momentary light afflictions. There's going to be a little persecutions. There's going to be a little suffering along the way. But Paul says these momentary light afflictions are nothing to be compared to the glory that's being revealed. You know, there's one scripture Paul says, I'm willing to suffer in my flesh that which was lacking in Christ's afflictions for your sake. So yeah, it might cost you a little something. It might be a little inconvenience for you. But yeah, the fruit of what you're going to receive in watching God accomplish his purpose and kingdom around you far outweighs whatever the temporal cost might cost you. Amen? I mean, I've been places I didn't want to go. You know, I've been in situations I didn't want to be in. But I didn't put myself there. I just said yes. And you know, 46 years ago, I might not have been so quick to say yes if I'd known what it was going to cost me. Amen. You know, but God, he didn't deceive us. He just didn't let us in on all the stuff that was going to happen. You know, he said, I've called you and I've chosen you. I said, man, that's great. I'm ready. But then I realized, oh, I didn't realize I signed up for this. But God in us is faithful. Now let's look at, I hadn't read the New American Standard in Mark 19. It says, so then when the Lord Jesus spoke to them, he received, and I read that one, it was the Passion I didn't read. Which one have I not read? Who's keeping track with me? And the Master, right? Okay.
You've read.
I read that one. And— see, I'm doing my deal instead of looking on my notes. But the point is that, you know, the Jesus in us is wanting to work through us. And that's what Rita, I think, was talking a little bit about. That, it, you know, there needs to be an expectancy within us, or a hope again rising up within us. Because a lot of the church has lost hope in what God has spoken. and they've lost hope to dream the impossible dream. You know, I love that song, to dream the impossible dream. Well, God has a dream for us, and he not only has a dream for us, he's accomplished that dream for us in Christ. That's why he said, I know the plans I have for you, you know, and for God to have a plan for us, then he had to bring all the stuff needed for us to accomplish the plan he has for us. It didn't say God has a plan for us, now go out and try to figure it out. No, he said, I got a plan for you. I declare the end before the beginning. So once we lay hold of the plan that God has for us, then we tap into the provision of what it takes to do the plan he has for us. So there's no limit in the provision that God has for us. That's why then John 15 says, whatever you need to do that which I've called you to do, just ask me and I'll give it to you that the Father may be glorified. Now, it's not talking about asking for Cadillacs and planes and you know, campers. Now, if you need those things to do what God's called you to do, then ask for them. But most of us don't need the things that the world thinks, you know, says is successful. We just need the provision of what God's called us to do. And whatever God's called us to do, we can ask him. And Jesus said, I will give you those things that the Father may be glorified, because Jesus knows the plan the Father has for us. And when we ask for the provision to accomplish the plan, it's freely given to us. Amen?
Amen.
So we need to lift off the limitations and the judgments that we've put upon ourselves, saying, well, you know, I just can't do that. This is just too difficult. There's nothing too difficult for our God and our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. I mean, you know, in my weakness, the scripture says, you know, we are strong because he fills us with his strength. You know, the best thing I can do in my flesh is death. The worst thing I can do in my spirit is amazing. Amen. Because Christ in me is the hope of glory. Am I making myself clear? Are you understanding what I'm saying?
Amen.
See, this is a season that we're in that we need to be the light of the world. You know, were you saying we're Jesus? I'm not saying we're Jesus. The scripture says we're Jesus. As he was, now we are. You know, but we are because it's him living in us, working through us to accomplish his purpose for us. So we've got the easiest job on the planet, and that's just going where he tells us to go and open our mouth and let him speak through us. Amen. Amen. Sister Sherry, comment a little bit.
This is awesome, brother. I believe every word of it. And it is the word. And I believe that you're right on target, and you're getting the good aim with your arrows tonight. So thank you. Just speak on.
And I would just encourage us to just do it. Ask the Lord, okay, God, what is the word that you've spoken to me? See, we need to know our place. We need to know our position. We need to know the calling of which we've been called with. And when we take ownership of the calling, then we need to let that word begin to take root within us as a seed, and let it begin to just cultivate in us, you know, and then as that seed begins to cultivate in us, then it will produce the purpose of what God has impregnated us with. You know, when Rita and I, we have two children, the seed that was planted produced a daughter. The seed that was planted produced a son. You know, the seed of God within us will produce life around us.
Amen. Amen.
And as we begin to just take ownership, you know, Ephesians says that we need, you know, that grace has been given to us, that Christ has given us the grace to take ownership of the call that's in us. And Rita got something to share, it looks like. You look like you're ready to preach. I had that, saw that Sherry anointing you.
You missed it, babe. Well, I was thinking of that, the song that I wrote several years ago is Be It Unto Me, as you've said. You know, talking about the seed. I mean, Mary, the Holy Spirit said, I'm going to put a seed within you that's going to produce the Son of God. And she said, basically, be it unto me.
You know, you've spoken.
And it's the same thing with as his people. When we when that word that we accept in our heart, and then when we pray and we said, Lord, let it come to fruition, it'll produce the results that God wants it to produce, which is Christ in us and him coming to full life and being who he wants to be in us, you know.
Amen.
And, amen.
Yeah, so, you know, I'm kind of going back to, you know, the part of taking courage and having confidence in the Lord. And I don't know who it was that said, I can't really find the scripture, but it talks about the basis of our confidence. I mean, if I just asked you, you know, what is the basis that, you know, when the Lord says, you know, don't lose your confidence, don't throw it away. You know, he tells us, you know, I've given you something here, and don't lose your confidence. And read it in Hebrews sometime. Hebrews is so great. And but what would you say for you would be the basis of why you can have confidence? I mean, just some things that come to your mind. I'll just go ahead and say it right now, and you can add to it in your thoughts, but the basis of our confidence is his covenant.
Yeah.
It's because he is a covenant-keeping God, and what he speaks to us, he will fulfill. His word will come to fruition. And so when he says, have confidence, have courage, we can count on it because he is a covenant-keeping God.
You know, there's a scripture, and I think it's Isaiah. I can't remember exactly where it's at, but it says something to the tone, says, you know, come state your case, put me in remembrance of what I've said, and watch me do it. And I think, you know, that's see, God gives us faith not in what we have to do. He gives us faith in what he has already done. Mm-hmm. You know, and because if I can do something, it doesn't take faith. But God always asks me to do something that I know I can't do in my own strength. So I have to have faith in his ability, faith in his strength, faith in his covenant, faith in what he's accomplished. Because unless God does it, it can't be done. And because I don't want what man can build. I want what God can build. I don't want what I can do. I want what God can do. I know what my actions produce, and it's not very good, but I also know what God's actions produce, and it's righteousness, it's pure, it's holy, it's eternal, it's everlasting. And that's who we are. See, we're no longer temporal people, we're eternal people. We're in the age, but we're not of this age. You know, we're living in the age that is to come, and the age which is to come is the fullness of God's kingdom being manifest on the earth. And that's where we're at. That's where we're seated. That's where we're positioned. And the age that is coming to make it known in this age, the fullness of the age that we live in.
Doug and I were, like he said, we were in Savannah last week, and not all the time are we asked to give our testimony. And anyway, but Kimberly and Daniel asked me to give my testimony, and I, you know, I can go into depth on my testimony, but there was younger kids there, and so I was like, Lord, what do I do? I mean, anyway, he kind of just, it was like he took me aside. He says, I want to speak to you about something. And I said, all right. And he says, you know, that scripture that says you overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of your testimony. And so I'm like, I heard this. And he says, the word of your testimony, you know, when you give a testimony, like if you're in a court or whatever, and you give a testimony, you're basically testifying what you know is truth, right? And so he said, Rita, he says, the word of your testimony is what you know to be true. And if we're people of faith and we believe what he speaks, when he says you are holy, without blemish, free from accusation, all of these things, we either can say, well, but I might have been okay yesterday, but today, man, I blew it. That's not what it says. It says, You are free from accusation in my sight. We receive his testimony of who he says we are. And that's how we overcome. We overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. What is our testimony? Who are we going to agree with? What are we going to declare to be true that will overcome the enemy? Something to think about.
And I choose to believe the testimony of the Lord. I think that's even scripture, isn't it? So anyway, so Father, I just thank you for our family. I thank you for those that we're fellowshipping with tonight, Father. And I thank you, Father, Lord, that, Lord, we just release the Holy Spirit to bring forth the word and the seed and the purpose that you have in each of their lives for this era, Lord, not just for this season, but for this new era that we're coming into, an era of your kingdom of God being manifest on the earth like we've not seen, Father. We thank you, Father, for faith rising up within, and we just come against the spirit of hopelessness. We come against the spirit of rejection. We come against the spirit of anxiousness. And Father, we just release the peace of God, peace of Christ that surpasses all understanding. Father, we call forth destiny, Father. We call forth purpose, Lord. We call forth ownership of the grace of the calling of the Lord Jesus Christ in each person's life. And Father, we just thank you, Lord, that this is a year of that there's going to be no more hesitancy. There's going to be no more delay in the dreams and in the visions that you put within our hearts. God, the things that we've been praying for, the things we've been fasting for, the things we've been longing for, Lord, this is an era that we're going to walk in the experience of that which we've been interceding for and believing for years, Father. Lord, this is going to be a year and of completeness, Father, in the things that we felt like has been misplaced and we've lost, Lord, you're bringing back to ownership and you're bringing back in alignment to your destiny in each of our lives. Father, we just release a new apostolic prophetic anointing on each one that's hearing. Father, an apostolic call to go and a prophetic anointing to speak. Father, that as they go, they'll speak. And as they go and as they speak, Lord, you'll be in the midst of where they're at to confirm and establish the things they're speaking and seeing. Lord, we just thank you for creative miracles. We thank you for new beginnings. We thank you for reconciliation. Father, we thank you for redeeming of time. Father, we thank you for salvation. Lord, we thank you for what the enemy's meant for harm. You're turning to good. What the enemy has stolen, you're reestablishing. Father, we thank you. This is a year of completeness and wholeness without any lack, Father. God, we just rise. We just call forth faith, Father. We call forth supernatural faith, an increase of faith, Father, an increase of expectation, an increase of knowing that you are the one that has called us and chose us and set us aside for your purpose, Lord, to proclaim your desire on the earth. And Father, we just come into agreement with your word and we say, Lord, we fully don't understand, but yes, Lord, we fully don't see ourselves there, but yes, Lord, Father, because you've said, we believe, Father, Lord, we believe what you've said, and we want to be the expression of who you've called us to be in Christ without limitations. So we just cast off the limitations and the judgments we put upon ourselves, and we say today that we're no longer limited by our understanding. We're no longer limited by our reasoning. We're no longer limited by our judgments, because you've set us free to be the full expression of who you've called us to be today. And Father, you said, let your kingdom come today on earth as it is in heaven. So, Lord, amen. Let it be released and let it be established, Father, today in Jesus' name. Amen.